I swear I'm going to quit these things, but right now I'm just addicted to them. Red Bull coconuts, really good. Anyway, what's going on, guys? Jason Osborne. And today we're going to be covering how to light your receptions and events coming up. All right, so how are we going to light receptions and events, or how can you improve on your reception and event lighting? Well, there's going to be a couple things that I want everyone to think about when it comes to lighting your receptions and events. That is ambient light. How much ambient light are you going to have in your venue, reception hall, conference room, etc., etc.? What is ambient light? Well, ambient light is simply, you know, background light. For example, the light behind me in this video, the blues, the oranges, things like that, that's considered ambient light. The light that, you know, if you're at a wedding venue or a reception hall and it's the uplighting going up the walls, that's ambient light. All the pretty light that usually sparkles when you have a wide open aperture and you're focused in on your subject and it's in the background, that's all considered ambient light. And I love ambient light because if you balance it correctly, you will get amazing shots for your reception and event coverage. It's going to start with the settings on your camera first, and you're going to want to focus on a couple things. One, you're definitely going to want to be in manual mode. You're going to be indoors, and you're going to want to be able to customize the settings of your camera to the indoor light that's being provided to you. Okay, so you're definitely going to want to be in manual. Second thing, you're going to want to slow your shutter speed down. Now, you don't need a super fast shutter speed in order to get really tack sharp images. You can still achieve a lot of sharp images with your shutter speed as low as 1/50, 1/60. And having that slow shutter speed is going to allow the camera sensor to pick up on all that little ambient light that's around you, which is going to help balance the flash that's going to be on your camera and possibly on your light stands as well. You're going to want to focus on your aperture. Now, your aperture definitely does not need to be wide open. I actually think that it should be around 2.8 to 3.5, depending on what stage of the reception is in. You're going to want to control the flash power that's either on the stands or on your camera, most likely going to be both, and aperture is going to be able to help you control that. Shutter speed is only going to help control the ambient light. Your aperture is what's going to control your flash, so you have to be mindful of that if you're shooting wide open, because your flash power might be too bright and you'll either have to adjust your flash power and lower that so that your wide open aperture doesn't overexpose your photo, or you're going to keep your flash power where it's at and increase your aperture, closing it up a little bit so that you're not blowing out your subjects. And your ISO is going to be anywhere between 1600 to 2000, 2500 if you need it. And maybe if you have a crop sensor, you might want to stick below 2000. I would say 2000 is the top for a crop sensor camera, especially if it's an older body. The newer bodies, they tend to can have a little bit less noise at higher ISOs. So if you have a newer style body with updated technology in it, go ahead, pump your ISO up to maybe 2000, 2500. If you go that high with an older style body, that's okay, but just be mindful that you're probably gonna have to use some denoise when you're editing your photos after the ceremony, reception, or event that you're covering. So just to recap the settings real quick for you, you're gonna want a slow aperture, 1/50, 1/60, maybe even 1/80. Even if there's motion going on in your reception, the dancing, things like that, they're not going to have too much motion blur to them. Typically, I've noticed that I can still get really tack sharp photos shooting as low as 1/60, especially if your camera has in-camera stabilization. So keep that in mind. You're going to want to have a slow shutter speed so that your camera has a time to absorb all that ambient light that's behind your subjects. Second, you're going to want to have an aperture of around 2.8 to 3.5. That way you can control your flash power on your subjects and not blow them out. But feel free to open it up and lower your flash power if you feel like you're not getting enough flash on your subject, or if it's still too dark of a scene. Lastly, your ISO, you're going to want to be anywhere between 800 to 2500 on your ISO. You shouldn't have to go any higher than that, especially if you have ambient lighting. Just want to make sure that your camera is suited with the settings to pick up that ambient light, and then also complemented with the flash. Speaking of flashes or speed lights, what type should you use? First, we're going to focus on the on-camera flash, and that's going to be the most important one that you have. I've shot weddings, receptions, and events with just my on-camera flash and no flashes on stand. So if you only have one speed light, that's okay. It is very likely that you'll still be able to get great lighting, producing great results with that one on-camera flash. So when you're using it one on-camera flash, all right, you're gonna have something like this on your camera, as you probably already know. Now, a lot of these come with a bounce card, as you already are familiar with. It's this white card that sticks up and it helps direct the light onto your subjects. These things can work somewhat well if you're only gonna have one flash, meaning no flashes on stands behind you or in around the room. This is something that you're probably gonna have to use, because shooting your flash straight up with nothing on top of it, no diffuser, no anything, your light, if the ceilings are too high, isn't gonna be able to bounce back onto your subject. Or if your ceilings are a different color, such as black, sometimes venues have that industrial look and they have black ceilings, your flash isn't gonna bounce anywhere due to the fact that, you know, black absorbs light. So having a bounce card is gonna help you direct the light onto your subjects. But as some people already know, the bounce card isn't that consistent, and sometimes it can really mess up a photo by putting too harsh of a light onto your subject. So if you have to use one, I would suggest, instead of keeping it all the way up as it is like this, lower it about 50%. So that way the initial flash hits it, goes onto your subject, but then it allows some flash to escape and not overpower your subject. But what I really recommend, if you're gonna use an on-camera flash, is to make sure that you use a diffuser on top of the flash. Basically what we're gonna do is, you're gonna wanna get one of these, put this right on top of your flash, fasten it, and this is gonna be on your camera. If you have this and only this on your camera, you'll be able to really light your receptions pretty well. And the reason for that is because this does a better job than a bounce card. You're gonna be able to hit a flash, this sphere spreads the light out evenly, softens, diffuses it, and allows it to hit your subject without having that bright, harsh, you know, blowout on their face. Now, I don't shoot at my subjects directly like this. I make sure to, you know, hold it straight up and let the light cover the area naturally. And how this helps is one, if you have nothing to bounce off of, the sphere will still spread the light, so it'll give you that bounce effect. And two, it softens the light to help, you know, control that blowout or that harshness that sometimes flashes can give your subjects during receptions. And three, it actually will, you know, help keep your light very true. Sometimes if you bounce off a painted wall, or if you bounce off a fabric backdrop, you know, some of that color will bounce onto your subject. This helps keep the color true, nice and clear, nice and white, and gives you a very good color cast. So I would definitely make sure that if you're only gonna shoot a reception or an event with one flash on your camera, you buy and invest one of these Gary Fong light spheres, or maybe even a mag sphere from Magpod. So that way you can get a good distribution of light and it's gonna stay true to the color. So what situations are appropriate for shooting with one flash and one flash only? Well, if you have a venue with low ceilings, the reason for that is because the ceiling is so low, you're gonna be able to bounce directly off the ceiling onto your subject, giving them flattering light. Situations like small events at houses, or small events in a small conference room or restaurant, something where the event is only happening in one single room, small dinner party, things like that. You're also gonna wanna make sure that your on-camera flash has the capability to trigger the other flashes if you need them. Typically, when I shoot my events and wedding receptions, I use three flashes. And what I use is, I use one on my camera, and then in the reception hall or in the room, I'll have two other speed lights on flash stands extended as high as they can go. They're about 8 feet each, pointed at each other. I'm gonna throw a diagram on the screen so you can see exactly what I'm talking about, so it doesn't sound as confusing. On the screen, as you see my subjects. Say it's the first dance, father-daughter dance, you know, son-mother dance, or just an open dance floor overall. You see the two subjects in the center of the dance floor. Then you see the speed lights facing each other, with their lights facing the subject or the center. And basically what this does, the lights on the flash stands are typically not used to really light your subject up. The flashes on the stands are used to increase the ambient light behind your subjects or around the room. I'm not using them to light up my subjects, I'm just using them to add flair to my shots. So basically it's gonna help brighten up the background And if you're lucky, or if you position your couple or your subjects right, you even get like a little starburst behind them. Look pretty cool depending on, you know, the type of atmosphere that you're in. So just to recap, you're not always gonna need a bunch of flashes to light your reception and events. If you're working a very small party in a small room with low ceilings, one camera flash is gonna be all you need, and it's just gonna be on your camera the entire time. Make sure that you get a diffuser so that that light can be spread out no matter if your ceilings are tall or low, and you'll have clean light coming from your flash at all times, no matter the color of the walls that you might be bouncing off of. You wanna make sure that your on-camera flash has the ability to radio trigger other flashes that you might be using around the room. This is gonna help you save time because you can control their power from your main camera flash, and you won't have to consistently pull your flashes down off the stand to make adjustments that you might realize you need throughout the evening. When it comes to using those flashes on stands, the power doesn't need to be high. You know, the lowest setting doesn't need to be something that's super high, because you're really not using those lights on stands to light your subjects. You're using it to provide additional ambient light so that the background isn't so shadowy and dark. So there you go. It's really simple. Hopefully these tips today help you light your receptions or your weddings or your events, and you know, you take them to stride. I know that I kind of just brushed over some of the things, but if you have questions, feel free to leave some in the comments below. I'll be happy to answer them. Until the next video, this is Jason Osborne. I'll see y'all in the next one. Peace.